Welcome to the Warren Cycling Podcast. My name is Dean Warren. I'm in Mainz, Germany today.
And I'm Randy Warren, and I'm in Niles, Michigan.
You almost said Asheville, North Carolina.
I almost did. Yeah. Just because I'm used to saying that. But last week it was Niles as well, though, I think.
Right. So. Yeah, you've got another gravel race coming up this Saturday, right?
Yeah, the 204-mile coast-to-coast from Saginaw Bay to Ludington. 204 miles. Yeah, a lot of sand. I free rode some of it there, you know, last week, and it was a lot of sand. It's been dry, no rain at all, hardly, except for the day we rode. We free rode. Got cold rain that day. But yeah, and it's supposed to be in the 70s this week, but then 80s on Saturday. So bump up the temperature. So hot, dry, and north wind, mostly north wind.
I would think there would be more sand closer to the Great Lakes, but in the middle of the state, I'm surprised it's so sandy. So I guess it's a pretty sandy state all around, isn't it?
Yeah, I guess too. And it's weird because it seemed like dirt sand. Like it wasn't like beach sand. It was like looked kind of like dirt, but it was sandy. And I even talked to Gaylord. I said, "Is this sand or is it just like really loose dirt, soft dirt?" He goes, "No, it's sand." I'm like, "Huh? It seems like just soft dirt."
Yeah, well, that could be a little tricky.
Yes. So people are predicting slow times because. Slow going through sand, soft sand especially.
Yeah, is that better than going through the mud at Unbound?
They both have their own
their own challenges.
Their unique challenges. Yeah. I don't know if it's better or worse. It doesn't collect on your bike. That's one thing's better, but it could get in and damage your chain, I guess, and stuff. I don't know. Yeah. I did put a new chain on though. I measured my chain after Unbound in the world qualifier and it was not that old of a chain, but it was stretched out. So I think all that rough weather is you know, mud and stuff, and it's wearing things out faster. So I've got a brand new chain.
Yeah. It's all the power that you're putting on the stressing the chain.
Maybe a little bit, but I got beat on the world qualifier for sure. So by one guy, from tough guy from Colorado. I'm already looking forward to the nationals. I got to beat this guy and anybody else who shows up too. But yeah, first we'll do this one here, so we'll see. So it'll be a long race no matter what, like 13 hours ish. So it'll be I rode 6 hours yesterday and I rode 5 last week, so if you combine those two rides, it's still not as long as what I'll ride in one day on Saturday.
So when you get to Gravel Worlds in Italy in October, it's going to be a much shorter race where you want it.
Yeah, it'd be more, I think, what the world qualifier was, 56 miles. I think the Italian one's more similar to that. So
yeah. All right. Well, we wanted to talk before, it's kind of almost too early to really talk about the Tour de France, because it's not just around the corner, it's just around the corner.
Yeah, but, we guess a little more than a week, so
we don't have rosters yet, do we?
I was going to say, we probably have preliminary rosters is all we have. Mm-hmm. We don't, sometimes the teams wait till just a few days beforehand to really finalize things.
Yeah, and then something happens to one of the riders and they're, you know, out mowing their lawn, and all of a sudden they have to hurry up and get to the start of the tour. So, I don't know. We'll talk a little bit maybe about the beginning of it, because it's going to be a different kind of tour with a couple of difficult stages starting in the Spain, the Bilbao area, with the Galicia part.
It's starting in Spain this year, and it's starting in Italy next year. Usually it alternates. Every, you know, 1 year is all in France, the next year is not. But the next 2 years, it's Spain and Italy.
Yeah, wow.
Crazy. It's Florence next year.
Yeah,
I'm paying attention a lot to next year because I was booking rooms in Paris and then in Nice for the finish of the tour next year in Nice. But yeah, it's I thought, you know what? To be honest, tell me about the beginning. I don't think I looked at it that closely yet.
No, well, I got my Velo Tour de France guide. Actually, I got two in the mail. I don't know why I got two. I got an email saying, do you want a hard copy mailed to you? I was like, yeah, I like it, because I guess maybe they don't want to send more to people that don't want it. But then they sent me two. I don't know why. So
maybe one's mine. I don't think I didn't get that email.
You can have it.
Yeah. I pay the $100 or whatever it is every year for the Velo subscription. But I might have one waiting for me at home. So hopefully I haven't been home for a couple of weeks, so maybe it's there.
Yeah, probably.
If it's not, though, save me. Because I like it. I like having the hard copy, flipping through it. It's easier than always looking online sometimes.
Yeah, for sure. I meant to have it next to me now, but it's behind me. I I had to get up and get it. So, but I've got behind me another Tour de France symbol, I guess, for this year, but not for next year, because they won't be racing around the Arc de Triomphe and down the, up and down the Champs-Élysées with their finish in Nice next year in 2024, changing the finish because of the Olympics in Paris next year. But I guess the most recent and the big topic is the Tour de Suisse that just finished. It's the other race that a lot of riders are using to get themselves ready for the Tour de France. And unfortunately, it was it was a very sad happening, because it was stage 4 or 5. Anyway, and the descent, Gino Mäder, the Swiss rider riding for Bahrain Victorious, crashed down a ravine and into some water even, but he was revived, but unfortunately he passed away on that stage, which really shocked a lot of riders. It's not the first time a rider has crashed and died in a big race. Like, it's happened in the Tour and the Giro, and even the Tour of Poland, you're just remembering. And, and other riders, unfortunately, have passed away from in training crashes and other rides. But this one seemed to...
Get my cars, those too, but yeah,
this one seemed to really shake up the peloton and the organizers. They did they cancel the next... No, they... Trying to remember exactly what they did. They did like a ride and just in his honor, but they didn't
race.
No, they didn't race. But then even the next day, they only raced after the 25 kilometers. So,
and even that too, seemed like it was. I think was it 100K? I thought they rode 75K, neutralized, and then they raced a little bit at the end. But it seemed like it was not really necessarily. Really racing.
They took the GC, and so I mean, Remco Evenepoel ended up winning the stage, and it's interesting for, because he's such a top rider, and I thought he was going to probably go away with the win on Sunday with the time trial, the final stage, but he's not getting ready for the Tour, so I mean, he probably wants to win all the time, but I was surprised. But no, it's such a shame to lose a rider like Gino Mäder, who seemed a really great guy. He was involved in donating money to help the environment and just very well liked. So yeah,
generally good guy. Some riders endear themselves to the rest of the peloton, and seemed like he was one of those guys that did. Everybody knew him. Really had all kinds of good things to say about him and his personality, and apparently he dedicated himself to the bike since he's been like 10 years old, and used it as therapy when his parents got divorced when he was 16, and just really, you know, loved riding the bike and was a real dedicated to that craft. So
it's just, it was good too.
It was really good. So our condolences certainly go out to everybody who knew him and his family, and we just want to express our sympathy for sure, you know. And it also adds that sense of mortality to all cyclists too, because as we said this before, that when you pin a number on, you never think you're gonna die, you know. You always think that worst case scenario, maybe have a crash and get some skin taken off, or maybe broke a bone, but you never think about really passing away. So when it happens, it's a reminder that, you know, that can happen for sure, and it's super sad, and it gives you a sense of mortality though for everybody too.
Yeah, no, there's definitely danger involved in this sport. So, I was thinking back even to the Tour of the Gila some years ago when my son Taylor was racing. I was at the race and actually drove by after the crash where Chad Young ended up dying, the Higgins Action Berman's rider, very young. Tragic scene there too. So, yeah, it can happen. So that just helps to reflect and always, not take every day for granted. And especially when you're out and can enjoy a bike ride, you want to appreciate every time you get out there and can ride and be safe.
Yeah. And that stage two, obviously, you know, is going to be forever known as the one that Gino Mäder died. But it also was kind of a really great stage from the racing standpoint, which of course is tempered by everything now too. But Juan Russo, who's 20 years old now, and who lost time the day before, just took off and gained a ton of time, had a great descent. It was amazing, amazing stage for him.
Oh, yeah. And then he put in an amazing time trial, too. He won the time trial on the last day, which I knew he was a good time trial. So he had been sick earlier this year. He hadn't really seen a lot of them. Another top rider for UAE Emirates, and another young Spanish rider that's rising up. But, yeah, and Felix Gall, the...
Yeah, I went to the tour of Romandie, too, just recently, too. So he was stage three of the time trial. He won this time trial there, too. So he is showing, yeah, he's one of the best time trials for sure.
Yeah. Well, he put in a great time trial, but it wasn't quite enough to win the overall because Matthias Gilmoes, the Segafredo rider, he pulled it out.
Started out with a really poor beginning.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he was behind. Yeah, that's right. I remember. Yeah, he gained time. He must have really knew where he needed to push the hardest and gain, where he could take back the time. And
he lost so much time at the first checkpoint that he was, I think, third on the GC, virtual GC at that point. So he was seemingly out of it. And I know one of the announcers on GCN, she was saying, too, that she thought for sure he had lost it all by that point because it seemed... You know, like it was an insurmountable deficit that he had given them. But somehow he came back and he even finished third overall in the time trial, too. Just nine seconds, 1 second off.
Oh, yeah. Well, nine seconds off. He came back really strongly. He's going to rush the tour, right? He's going to be a big help for Tadej Pogačar. We don't know. We were just saying we didn't know the final rosters yet for the tour. It's today. We didn't set the date here. It is June 20th. It's almost the longest day of the year, right, for the Northern Hemisphere people. June 20th, episode 328 of the Warren Cycling Podcast. And I was going to see no races on his program coming up. So.
Yeah, it's insane. Yeah. I don't know. He's certainly fit. I mean you for someone that young, you want to give him the experience for sure when he can, and he certainly could be a good helper. It depends on partly who Pogačar wants to be there with him and how comfortable he is in that environment maybe. And there's probably lots of things that they have such a strong team, team.
And Brandon McNulty was really helping Tadej Pogačar in the mountains last year a lot. It seemed like he was really strong. He's not doing this year's. I mean, he did the Giro, so he could be fatigued from that. And I was going to see what they have on the list right now. Could change. Start list.
Yeah, the preliminary start lists are up there, but
Who is UAE changing right now?
It's interesting because Cavendish is on there with Astana and Sace Bol, who is his lead out man. They hired to be lead out man, and they've hardly raced together at all. But they're hopefully supposed to race together there. Dombrowski's on their list too at Astana. We raced in the Giro too. So
okay, well to help Teddy though right now, it's got Adam Yates. Okay, he was really good.
He's riding well.
Yeah. Mikael Bjerg, who. Didn't he won a time trial, right? Recently. Mikael Bjerg. Langen.
He won the stage region, right? You're right. Dauphiné, yeah.
Groschartner, Mark Soler, Rafael Majka, and Domen Novak. So he's a fellow countryman. He's a Slovenian to help Tadej Pogačar.
Yeah, that's true.
Mark Soler, he's the one you never know what's going to happen with Mark Soler.
Right. Is he racing for himself or for others? It seemed like, Movistar, that was always an issue. Micah, though, he's a workhorse for sure. Then Groschartner, too, he's a workhorse, too.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
It'd be hard to see those guys not make it. Yeah.
So, preliminary. No, maybe he's really going to go for it at the Vuelta, being a Spaniard.
Now that I think about it, I think they did say that was the
as big
computer. Yeah.
Well, that makes sense.
It does make sense.
Yeah. What else on the Tour of Swiss? Doesn't seem like, I don't know. It seems like before the Dauphiné and the Tour de Suisse were like really showcasing the riders getting ready for the tour. So Juan Ayuso was really up there. Skilmos, is he on their list? Because Skilmos pulled out the win and you don't think, well, he's not like a tour contender.
Yes. Yeah, he is on their list.
Yep. Yeah. And he should be in good shape for it. Yeah, he's doing real well. We were talking, and I think.
Who's Trek, you know, who's their Bacamolma, maybe? Ciccone? I mean, they don't really have. They've got a lot of stage hunters, for sure. You know, Peterson. Yeah. You know, they got Lopez. I don't know. So, they've got a lot of stage hunters. I don't think they have a GC person. So maybe Skilmos might be their
top 10.
Yeah. That might be, yeah.
But it's pretty big for a team.
Oh, for sure. Yep.
Yeah.
Michael Woods, too, he was tearing it up. He won that French race again this year. I think he won last year, too. He won two stages in the overall. And that, you know who I don't see on the Israel Primatech start list? Chris Froome.
Oh, Chris Froome, yeah.
No. Is he not going to start it? He hasn't shown any spectacular form, but at the same time. He's like the third highest paid, last I saw, the racer. You know, it seemed like they'd bring him. They don't have
only have seven riders.
Yeah, so maybe he's the, maybe they're waiting to. And I did see something that there was an article saying that something that he still said that was the something that his highest desire is to do the tour. So I don't know. He was third place last year at Alto Ez, so third place, right? Second place, third place. You know, in the Alto Ez stage, he
US?
Third place, I think, wasn't it? Yeah, he had flash of brilliance there.
Nine-time Pidcock, huh?
Yeah, it was Pidcock, and Pidcock won, right?
Yes.
And then someone else was second, and then he was third, I think. So I don't know. Who knows? It'd be interesting to see. So what happens with that? It's only a week away, like you said, too. It's such a... Such a lot of things that could happen yet.
Crazy. That's my Garmin. I'm really liking this 530 Garmin. Did you see it? You confirmed it?
Yep, third place in Alto Ez stage. Stage 12.
Yeah, you're faster than me. I just pulled up. Yeah.
He was in a break. And Pidcock stormed the break, joined the break, and then took off from the break. But Froome held on to finish third, though. Yeah, so I don't know. It's a lot of storylines for sure. Pogacar, whether his wrist is going to be healed up enough, you know, Vindigo, if he's, you know, it seems like he's flying right now. You know, it may somebody from the outside, maybe. Right now it seems like it would be a two-person show, but you never know for sure.
Yeah, well, it starts out pretty, like, I don't know. I have to pull it up again, 14,000 feet of climbing or whatever the first day. I mean, it's going to be one of the most difficult first stages. 14,000
feet of climbing the first day?
Well, let me get the book. I got to get the book now. It's 11,000 feet. Hold on here.
Yeah, I got to see if I can find the stages here for it, too. So I got the film to start the route. Here we go. Route.
Disappearing. Yeah, it's going to be one of the more difficult first stages in a long time. First two stages are going to be pretty difficult.
Well, usually you have the ability for the jersey to change hands and all that kind of stuff too. So that, you know, like you don't have one person taking over the jersey, but if you finish, so the first day's got, I don't think that's that many feet of climbing. It's got a three category climbs. Yeah.
It's got a Muir de Huy type climb. 11,000 feet. Okay, that was it. I knew.
It's still pretty good, though. It's pretty good. So it's broken up, though. So it's going to definitely be a really hard stage, for sure.
Yeah. But it's going to have a Muir de Huy kind of a climb, like, before the finish, and then an uphill finish. Yeah. But it's going to drop a lot of people on that climb. Oh, yeah.
It's steep. The 2 kilometer, 9.9% average grade for 2K.
So I think it hits 15% somewhere.
Yeah. And then it's downhill, then an uphill sprint finish. Mm-hmm. And then the next stage too is pretty easy. It's up on a plateau that has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 category climbs.
Yeah.
Yeah, 2 at the end. And the next one's got pretty lumpy stages too. 3. So I mean, I guess you could see this. It's dynamic. You can see the change, the changing hands. You know, the stage 5 in Po, that has an OR category and a Cat 1 climb on it. But again, no mountaintop finish at the end.
Stage 6,
an OR category in 2-1s, including a mountaintop finish.
Yeah. That's
right. The race could theoretically be over after stage 6.
but if Terry Pogacar is like not quite, you know, hitting all cylinders yet, it's going to be difficult for him right there in the beginning.
Yeah, he might barnstorm the end. Huh. Remember when Yates was in the Giro so far ahead, won 3 stages and was way far ahead, and then was it Chris Froome that year that came back from 5 minutes down and took it all back in one stage? You know, you never know. Because the first week is so hard, people might be, you come in flying, it's going to be an advantage for sure, but you're right, they may not be able to hold it for the, it's kind of like a Tom Pidcock kind of thing, or not Tom Pidcock, but, you know, it's Evan Poole maybe. You know.
Matteo Vanderpool.
Yeah.
He's coming to a good form.
Really good form. He's flying. He crushed the Tour of Belgium.
Well, Van Aert is coming to pretty good form, although he wasn't able to win a stage at the Tour de Suisse, but he's coming into good form. And Julian Alaphilippe. These kind of riders are going to show themselves right away, I think.
You know, actually, too, I like that. Julian Alaphilippe, these are kind of his kind of stages the first couple of days. They're the kinds that he can win.
Exactly. Yeah.
And stage 9 finishes up an OR category climb, too. It's tough. This is a tough. When's I don't know if Cavendish is going to have a chance on stage 4, maybe. That's the first 4, chance.
Maybe, yeah. But now, the one advantage I think Jasper Philipsen has maybe over some of the other sprinters is that Matteo Vanderpool, when he leads him out.
Yeah. It's a good lead out.
Very good lead out, yeah. Otherwise, Fabio, I think they each won at the Tour of Belgium, didn't they? Win a stage. Fabio Jakobsen is going to be one of the fast finishers, of course, too. But they're going to have to.
Grunewegen, is he going to do it too?
Yeah. So.
But you know, one thing though too, Cavendish is in good shape right now. When he was in the Giro, which he finished, of course, the last stage, he got the win, last stage. But people are saying he was not the first person in the autobus. He was not struggling on the climbs like a lot of the other sprinters were. That he was riding much more comfortably than most sprinters were in the Giro. So this might be a good thing for him that it's such a hard race too, because even stage 4 and stage 7, or might be sprinter stages, but they're going to be tired after going after all these other climbing stages. You know, they're going to be so much climbing in these stages that the sprinters might have their legs a little zapped, you know, and so it might be a little harder for them to muster up their normal good sprint. So somebody who's just in, you know, better overall fitness might have a better chance.
I think Mark Cavendish is going to have more difficulty with this lead out.
Case Bowl is the only, now I get to ride with him.
And that everyone will be really in their top form. So.
And the pressure, too. Of course, he handles
pressure
pretty well. But, the chance to break Eddie Merckx, break the tie with Eddie Merckx. So.
Yeah, we'll see. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, looking forward. We did see that probably this weekend, including in the United States, is the Pro National Championship. Of course, the ones that come to the U.S. are unlikely to be racing the Tour, but you get to see maybe another indication who's really flying or on good form coming into the Tour, how they'll do, and they get to wear their new jerseys that they'll win at the National Championship. So
usually
we got those to look for. The U.S. just had their amateur national championship, so we might as well mention that, because C.S. Velo, the team that my son Taylor rides for, they cleaned up. Yeah, they got second and fourth in the time trial. And then their new rider, who won last year the amateur road race championship, Aminsik, who hasn't done so much yet this year, but, he pulled it out and back-to-back national championships on the road. Taylor helped to set him up.
Yeah.
And then Taylor got fifth in the criterium. So
Yeah, he was frustrated too, because he thought himself in a good spot to do even better. I did read about Brandon Fury's report. He said that he jumped on the last corner too, knowing it was so critical, it'd be a long sprint. So he was first person out of the corner, I think, and it did. Taylor was boxed in and couldn't get around. So yeah, it came from a break too. So it was a 6-person break or something like that. There was sprinting 7-person break, was it something like that?
Taylor came into that last corner in fifth position and finished fifth, but it looked like it wasn't that close to the finish, but
close. No, enough. It was a long sprint. He said, yeah.
Yeah.
But for some reason, Brandon was just saying it was, he thought it was going to be a long sprint. So
yeah.
Yeah.
And Michael Hernandez, who was last year's Criterion winner, he was third. So, and the podium picture was nice to see Taylor and Michael next to each other because they raced as juniors together in Florida, in Central Florida. So that's, you know, more than 10 years ago they were.
Yeah. Together again on the podium there. Yeah. And yeah. A great many of those people are going to be now in Knoxville this weekend. And the crit, you know, not an easy crit by any means, but still it's not super hard course, but the road race course is just that hill over and over and over again. And this is the last year, I think, right, in Knoxville.
I hope so, because I think they need to have a little more variety. I mean, it's a pity that the United States doesn't have so many places that want to host these championships. That would be, I mean, they've run them for a long time because, you know, they got some place to host it. Yeah. I mean, it's Greenville for how many years? I don't know. That was a good venue too. Yeah. I mean, also this Knoxville, Greenville, they're fairly close to each other as far as the whole big country. Right. So, but,
it's both gonna be hot and humid too, so you're not cool and dry or dry and hot, or yeah, the same kind of temperatures. Yeah, and like you said, yeah, it's a hard the Knoxville road race is a very specific type of climbing. It's just over and over and over, so your VO2 max over and over and over. It's not long enough to be really threshold, and you know I remember, you know, people saying before that you backed off the threshold at some points in the race. So It's like doing VO2, you know, repeats. It's a hard, but it's also a special effort kind of course. There's other courses that are very hard too. If it was like a more long extended climb, maybe like Paris Mountain was, but even that one's not super long. No. But you know,
not for these guys.
Yeah.
I don't know how many times I could go. I mean, well, you did an Everesting, so you can do lots of climbs over and over and over.
Yeah, but not as fast as guys doing it. So yeah. Yeah, I know it's hard, but it's just different. It should be different types of hard, you know. So
it's, yeah, always, I think so. It's to favor different riders and different types of riders, and that's what I mean. That's what the world championships are. I mean, they have different courses and
yeah, some dead flat, some hilly, some mountainous. Yeah,
yeah, like Copenhagen.
It'd be interesting to see. Well, even the one in Norway, right? It had a climb at the end of the time trial, which is, you think it was flatter, but they had a big, pretty significant climb at that. So
yeah. Well, Scotland, I don't think they're gonna have. They don't have such big. I don't think they'll have that big a climb.
Short punchy. Yeah.
So, wow. So we're jumping all around. yeah.
I'm still looking at stages of the tour.
yeah. Well, I didn't. I mean, it's funny with the guide. You know, they have to print it so early because they don't know exactly who's
good. They do most of the content in like the wintertime. Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, you know, and they always
got his broken wrist or, you know, anything like that too.
Yeah.
Do they have as a 5-star favorite? Who do they have? They've got Pagacha and Vitico. And who else? Anyone else?
I haven't even seen there. I just started looking through it earlier today as I landed in Frankfurt, but then I took a really short nap. I wanted to get out and ride and enjoy the warm weather. It's in the upper 80s here, but I saw the wind.
Cool weather for you.
Yeah, I know.
It's pretty hot.
Hot here is not, it's not Florida hot, so it's fine for me. But I took the trains because I got a train pass. And so I thought, well, I can get to different places. So I took the train to ride, which I thought was going to be pretty good tailwind, but it was more cross tailwind. So it didn't help me all the time. And I came up from Ludwigshaven up to Mainz, but...
Wait, so you took the train out and then rode back to tailwind?
Yeah. Yeah, I have that choice. I could take the train out and ride against a headwind and come back. So.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't even see like the like Velo having a Tour de France preview yet for their on their website. Usually they're like overall preview, right. But then
the GCN, have they done a video yet for that? They're probably waiting that too, huh? But the, I guess the other the other thing is not a preview at all.
Next Monday.
Netflix released the Tour de France Unchained series, and there's podcasts that are talking about the Netflix series. So I haven't watched
any.
Have
you seen any?
No, I haven't seen.
I heard it would make you a fan of the Tour de France.
No, so I'm gonna see it. I plan to see.
Yeah, I'd like to see. I haven't seen it either yet, too. So
yeah.
I'm not sure when I will. I'd like to.
we don't have any news on that.
No,
he was starting to watch. I was asked him how. He has to tell me how it is.
I did tell. I asked my wife Carrie. I said, "Hey, this is getting a lot of talk," and she goes, "Oh, I haven't heard anything about it." So maybe it's only getting a lot of talk in the cycling world and not in the general world.
Yeah, I have to talk to some of my crew members if they've stumbled on it or not. I don't know.
Yes.
So. Yeah. I'm like a little bit lost for anything else to talk about. We saw a Tour of Colombia going on. Michelangelo Lopez is running some stages there, but that's not too interesting for me, at least.
We were saying Lopez earlier, though, too. He's done some of the U.S. races. Did he do a Gila, too? I know he did.
Yeah, I did. He was leading. He won the first stage and the second stage. According to Taylor, he got to like a fight or something, crashed a bunch of people, and then he crashed out and they didn't finish. So,
And then Joe Martin, he was second there. He got beat in the crit at the end.
Yeah,
he was winning.
Yeah, he was leading, and Riley Sheehan and the Denver Disruptors disrupted his race. That's a tough crit, that last day of Joe Martin. We've seen it swing around a bunch of times. I think, did Nielsen Paulus like take it away the 1 year?
Oh, yeah. I won it as a Masters 1 year. It was fun. It was a good lead out there.
Yeah, it's a good area. The Tour of Slovenia was supposed to be the warm-up the last other race that Tadej Pogačar was going to do. It drew some pretty solid riders this year. And I didn't even see it. Felipe Lozano won.
I don't know.
So I'm pulling up right now. Yeah. Stage 5. And then
put on the GC. Yeah.
GC final, right? Mateo Mahorik won stage 5. Zana was second.
Oh, yeah. No, Zana won it.
Zana won the overall.
Yeah, by 18 seconds.
He was doing well at the Giro.
Elisi was third. Mahorik was second. Elisi, yeah. That's Walt Poles was ninth. So
it's not that big ride. Like so, Tadej Pogačar did it before, and he runs away with it, and you can't pull a lot from how good his shape is because he doesn't have a big contender to race. Yeah. So
it's all good race, but you know it's a 2 point pro, not a 1 point pro. Or a 2 point pro is not a 2 point world tour. That's a two just means the stage race, and then pro is a notch below the world tour.
World tour, yeah. Well, the women had a Tour de Suisse this year, and it was a Swiss woman from SD Works, Marlene Reusser, that got the win there. I think
SD continuing to dominate for sure.
Yeah, I think Voss won the first stage. Blanca Voss, the Hungarian rider. She rides for SD Works. So.
Did anybody from SD Works not win?
Yeah, that's what I was just wondering there, too. Because
the time trial, no? Yeah. Rooster, this was this. Yeah. Yes. On stage 3. Gasparini won, UAE Emirates. Yeah, so there's a bunch of sprint finish. The first SD Works person was Voss that day too, in fourth. So yeah, wow. one day they upset the apple cart for that one for sure. But it took a while.
Right.
It must have been a hard day. They put a few DNFs.
They have the women's Giro Rosa coming up, just starting, I think, on the 30th, right? June, a couple of days before the tour.
That's a tough spot to be because you get a lot of the attention taken off of the race. So you'll get a couple of days of you know, seeing the, I mean, this phenomenal women's racing. It used to be by far the hardest. Now it's still the hardest and longest women's stage race. But yeah, it's gets a little overshadowed by the tour after that. What Americans are doing that this year? What are the preliminary start list is pretty empty. Mariana Voss, there's Annemiek van Vleuten, is one person in place, you know, Nia Doma. It's Nia Mova. Yeah. Anne Marie Verst. Yeah, not very many people on there. So Human Powered Health will be there. So probably have some Americans there. Jake Olula, I wonder if Kristen Faulkner, maybe she's going to be doing it. EF Education, of course, typical SUV, have some Americans. So sure. Yeah, there'll definitely be some Americans there.
Yeah, we'll check in on that when that happens. So let's we're just reaching for stuff right now. So I think we need to do a birthday to wrap it up. You can work on your, you got to book some places to stay. You got to book your place in Italy for Gravel Worlds, right? You have to place your nationals right in Nebraska too. You've got that to set up. So
that's probably more important. I did book up. So far, I've only booked a rental car because those seem like the hardest things to get right now. So I booked a rental car, but not my flight or the hotel yet.
All right.
The race information, you can't register till I think July 14th, and there's very little information. There's no information about the course or anything yet either. So, it should be okay. But I should, but it's a very, very small community of like 5,000 people. So there may not be many housing options. So I probably should do that next.
Yeah. All right. Well, get on that. But before, I'm looking at the birthday list, and I'm pretty happy because number 5 on the list today, June 20th. Is Robin Carpenter, Human Powered Health, who actually crashed and broke his collarbone earlier. He should be coming back. Maybe he'll be at Nationals. He's 31 today. So
He likes to come to Nationals too, for sure. So
He's usually in the break.
last year, right? He was getting close to coming to the line, but so this year, when did he break his collarbone? Was it at Athens Twilight Crit? Was that when he broke it? No, he finished third there. No, he finished third. So it must have been after that then.
Yeah. He won the Tour de Alberta. He won a stage at the USA Pro Challenge, a stage at the Tour of Britain, stage at the Tour of Utah. He's won the overall at Joe Martin and the Cascade Cycling Classic. So solid rider. I thought he was one of the best riders that never got a World Tour contract.
Yeah, at 31, probably not going to happen either. But yeah, he definitely has a lot of top results down there for sure. He
crashed in the Spartanburg Criterium.
Spartanburg. So Athens Twilight Crit, I think that was one of the first races of the series. And Spartanburg was shortly after that. So that's end of April, and maybe end of June. So he should be back racing now. So there's a Legion this year too, changed teams from Powered Health and Rally before that.
Yeah. Right now he's on Legion. I think I said he was Human Powered Health. Legion for sure. Legion, two-time winner of Eschborn Frankfurt, celebrating his birthday today. Also won twice the Grand Premier Miguel Indurain. Top of the list is Fabian Wegmann, German. 43, so he's not even that old.
No.
Birthplace Munster. Munster, I believe, is a university town that's one of the best cycling towns, bicycle-friendly towns in all of Germany. Munster.
I know you've broadcast on this date before because Mike McCarthy's birthday today, 55, was the pro pursuit champion. But we used to have a pro, and now they have elite pursuit 4K. Pro pursuit was 5K. He was world champion with the 5K world pursuit title. So,
excellent.
And then Giovanni Lombardi too is 54. He's number two on the list. We should mention him. He's a quality racer too. He won four stages of the Giro and two of the Volta and three of the Tour of Suisse. None of the Tour though. Lots of stage wins though. He was a big sprinter. So he,
yeah, and he was 13 times second at the Vuelta a España.
Other stages, yeah. Yeah, won two stages though, too, so 59. But he won two stages of Trentino-Adriatica, two stages of Catalonia, two stages of Romandy. You know, he's just, you know, six times second in Giro d'Italia, too. It'll go along with the four stages wins, you know, second in Milligan. So, yeah, good sprinter, lots of things. He finished with CSC. They raced for Telecom for a long time. So, you know.
Chad Hartley's birthday today.
42. Chad Hartley, all right.
Good for Ken to 5R Energy.
I would say Mike McCarthy our time for his, what else he's done, too, because he's the you know, the world champion of the track, but two stages of the Tour de Japan, second place, two stages of the Tour of Japan, second on Tour de Japan. So I guess those are his big ones. So maybe the world championship on the track is the biggest thing
they've ever done. Perhaps so. Yep. It's Christian Santa's birthday today. He's 27. All right. What a name to have, Santa.
Hey, Santa. Yeah. Travis Monroe, his birthday.
Catherine Lundby. Ryan Olkers. All right. I think we probably lose a lot of people by this time, don't we?
Maybe.
As we're scanning through. Unless their birthday is the day and they're waiting for
whose birthday is it? Can just go look, I suppose, too. Yep. Yep.
All right. I think I'm pretty hungry, too, because I didn't have a chance to eat. After our ride,
so we're gonna go see our sister's new house in Orville's house today. So do that, but yeah, in the meantime, I should go for an hour spin and
You got extra daylight today, so take use of it.
Yeah, we'll probably be back before it's dark. Yeah. And so I have to carry back to the airport tomorrow in Chicago. So I'm gonna go see Vision Quest and get the inside test done for Vision Quest, you know, too. And then go for a ride with my good friend George Langford afterwards. And he went to Giro Sardinia with me this year. So
excellent. So I'll be in Chicago. Ride the Lakefront Trail? Where are you going to ride?
He's going to meet me up in Highland Park or on his way to Highland Park. We have to still work out the detour details. So he'll be not in the Lakefront Trail, probably not. I did walk on it the other day when we were there, because I wanted to see the Navy Pier flyover, which I started working on like in 2001 or two. It was a $3 million project and it ended up being a $40 million project that got completed like 2 years ago. So
$3 million to $40 million?
Yes, $3 million to $40 million. And 15 more years. So maybe more than that, 17 years. Yeah, it was a crazy big project. So yeah. But part of it though is exactly how I worked on it. Like the northern terminus of it, we spent forever designing that northern part, and it's exactly how we designed it 18 years ago, 19 years ago, whatever. So yeah,
it works good.
So it's fun to see those things. It's packed though. We were there on Saturday, but the trail's packed. So yeah, I think we're gonna ride some Lake County roads and stuff probably.
All right, sounds good.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I hope we get to talk maybe before the tour starts, because I'll be in Bali for most of the tour. I'm not sure how I'm going to be watching.
What do you think?
I don't leave till the 4th, so those big, you know, those stages that are going to maybe set the tone are already. I'll be able to see those.
Maybe the 3rd. We can talk on the 3rd. You think? Yeah. It's Monday.
Come in that day. Maybe we'll see. All right.
Oh, we'll work something out. I've got an event I'm running on the 4th. We have a Consider Haiti ride. So if you're anywhere near Asheville, check for a bike ride. Consider Haiti, 4th of July. There's a mixed surface gravel ride and a family ride. That I lead the family ride. 7 miles through Asheville, slow paced. Matthew and I ride the tandem. And then there's a lunch immediately afterwards. And then there's a fun dinner that evening where we have live music, great food from Chop Shop Butchery, watch the fireworks display. So if you're anywhere near Asheville on the 4th of July and want to ride your bike, come look for, if you search on Bike Reg for Consider Haiti 4th of July rides, then you'll find the registration there and join us.
All right. Sounds good. Excellent. All right. Thanks, Randy. Talk again soon.
All right. Yep. All right. Bye now.